On the NewsHour tonight, a new Alzheimer's drug. The FDA approves a controversial treatment for the disease despite mixed results in clinical trials. Then, impasse at the Capitol. A major voting rights bill faces crucial opposition in the Senate as the president and Republicans remain far apart on infrastructure. And voices of the virus. Members of the South Asian diaspora share their experiences trying to help loved ones in India amid the deadly COVID surge.
The emotional aspect of it is something which I don't think I've had adequate time to process through. And I'm just trying to keep myself busy, but I know I'll get back to it at some point and have to reconcile with that.
All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
Before we talk about your investments, what's new?
Well, Audrey's expecting.
Twins.
Grandparents.
We want to put money aside for them, so change in plans.
All right, let's see what we can adjust.
We'd be closer to the twins.
Change in plans.
Okay.
Mom, are you painting again? You could sell these.
Let me guess, change in plans?
At Fidelity, a change in plans is always part of the plan.
Consumer Cellular. Johnson & Johnson. BNSF Railway. Financial services firm, Raymond James. The William and Flora Hewlett Foundation. For more than 50 years, advancing ideas and supporting institutions to promote a better world. At Hewlett.org. The Chan Zuckerberg Initiative, working to build a more healthy, just, and inclusive future for everyone at CZI.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
I'm Stephanie Tsai at NewsHour West. We'll return to Judy Woodruff and the full show after the latest headlines. The U.S. Food and Drug Administration today approved the first new drug to treat Alzheimer's disease in nearly two decades. Federal health officials said it may help slow the brain-destroying disease's progression. But the approval goes against the agency's independent advisors, who said the treatment wasn't effective in clinical trials. We'll have more on this after the news summary. The Justice Department has now recovered a majority of the cryptocurrency payment demanded by hackers after last month's Colonial Pipeline ransomware attack. The Bitcoin ransom, which is currently valued at $2.3 million, was seized from the Russia-based hacker group DarkSide. Deputy Attorney General Lisa Monaco made the announcement this afternoon.
By going after the entire ecosystem that fuels ransomware and digital extortion attacks, including criminal proceeds in the form of digital currency, we will continue to use all of our tools and all of our resources to increase the cost and the consequences of ransomware attacks and other cyber-enabled attacks.
The cyber attack on Colonial Pipeline forced the company to shut down its operations for 5 days, triggering major shortages at gas stations on the East Coast. Protests surrounding the Enbridge Line 3 construction project in northern Minnesota turned more serious this evening. Protesters occupied a pump station and later clashed with police. At least 30 people were arrested. Earlier, the company said it had evacuated 44 workers from the site. Later in the program, I'll have a conversation I taped earlier earlier with a Native American protester. Vice President Harris was in Guatemala today to discuss the surge in immigration from Central America to the U.S. She met with Alejandro Jamate in Guatemala City. They discussed economic opportunity, anti-human trafficking measures, and a new U.S.-backed task force to fight corruption in the region.
There are many reasons why this is one of our highest priorities, which I think the people of Guatemala know well, and the people of the United States understand well. If we are to be effective, if we are to be true to our principles, we must root out corruption wherever it exists.
She'll meet with the president of Mexico tomorrow. Back in this country, the U.S. Supreme Court unanimously ruled that people who immigrated illegally to the U.S. for humanitarian reasons are ineligible to apply for a green card to become permanent residents. The court also decided not to take up a case to determine if the U.S. military draft discriminates against men. In southern Pakistan, at least 51 people died and more than 100 others were injured after a pre-dawn collision between two express trains. One of the trains derailed in the city of Ghatki shortly before the second train crashed into it. Rescue crews rushed to find survivors trapped in the wreckage. Investigators are still trying to determine the cause. The death toll from a jihadi extremist attack on a village in northern Burkina Faso Friday night has risen to at least 132 people. Insurgents burned down homes and the local market while shooting at villagers. Many of the injured were taken to nearby hospitals to be treated for bullet wounds and burns. The regional governor called it a tragedy.
A man in shock is speaking to you right now. You've seen the injured. There's even a little girl who is less than 5 years old. You saw men and women who got shot in the back. These types of actions have no human soul. No one can watch this and go home and sleep in peace.
Back in this country, states are taking measures to combat the worsening western drought. In California, the main water provider in Santa Clara County, which serves 2 million residents in and around San Jose, said it would declare a water shortage emergency this week. And Nevada is the first state in the nation to outlaw certain types of grass. Governor Steve Sisolak signed the legislation Friday. The ban targets non-functional turf at office parks, street medians, and entrances to housing developments. It excludes single-family homes, golf courses, and parks. And billionaire Amazon founder Jeff Bezos will be flying into space next month on a rocket made by his company, Blue Origin. He'll be joined by his brother and the highest bidder in a charity auction. The trip to space and back will take just 10 minutes and will launch July 20th. Still to come on the News Hour, what you need to know about a controversial new Alzheimer's drug. Protests intensify as a new pipeline threatens indigenous lands in Minnesota. Members of the South Asian diaspora try to help loved ones amid the COVID surge, plus much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
The FDA's approval of a new Alzheimer's drug today followed months of debate within the medical community about the agency's procedures, which, as Amna Nawaz reports, the announcement has done little to quiet.
That's right, Judy. The approval was based on two clinical trials. One showed some improvement in patients who'd been given the drug aducanumab, but the other found no benefit. A number of practitioners said that was not good enough and fell short of the FDA's usual standards for approval. And in November, an outside advisory board recommended the FDA not approve the drug. But other medical professionals said the need was so great that any medication that offered promise was worth trying. The last treatment for Alzheimer's came on the market some 18 years ago. Pam Bellock is a health reporter for the New York Times. She's been following all these developments closely, and she joins me now. Pam, welcome back to the NewsHour. Thanks for making the time. Let's start with that news of the approval today. Even with this disagreement over how effective the drug is, the FDA still approved it. Why? What do we know about what they based that on?
Well, what they said was they actually acknowledged that there was not clear evidence of clinical benefit, that there was some kind of murkiness in the evidence about whether this will actually help patients slow down their memory and thinking problems. But what they said is there's some suggestion of that. And one thing that everybody on all sides agrees that the drug does do is that it attacks a key protein in Alzheimer's disease. This is a protein called amyloid, and it's the protein that clumps into plaques in the brains of people who have Alzheimer's. So they said, well, we're going to approve this drug because it does attack the biology of the disease. We have some signal that there might be some benefit for patients' symptoms, and we're going to tell the company that they need to do another clinical trial. And if the results of that trial do not show benefit, then the FDA might revoke the approval, and it could end up being that those trials don't show benefit at all. The issue with that is that the clinical trial takes 3 or 4 or 5 years, and so this drug will be on the market. Patients will be using it without actually being certain that it has the ability to help them.
So while the drug is out there, I'm assuming there's going to be high demand for it, right, with millions of people in the U.S. suffering from Alzheimer's. Do we know enough about the benefits and the risks at this point? What did they find in the trials in terms of the risks that people take on in taking this drug?
Yes, there's definitely a risk. This drug can cause brain swelling and brain bleeding. And in the trial, about 40% of patients in the trial did experience that. Now, it's not quite as serious as it sounds because most of those cases didn't actually produce any symptoms for patients, but some number did, and about 6% of patients had to quit the trials because of the brain swelling or brain bleeding. So those can be serious side effects, and as a result, anybody who takes this drug will have to have regular brain MRIs to check to see if their brain is experiencing anything like this. In terms of the benefit that they found, and as you said in the beginning, only one trial found any benefit. Another completely identical trial did not find any benefit. The benefit in the trial that did seem to be positive is actually quite slight. So some of the scientists who were concerned and arguing against approval were saying, we don't have a slam dunk here. We only have one trial that shows any possibility of benefit, and that benefit itself is pretty slight. And then on the other side, we know that there is a risk. And so they were saying the potential benefit here doesn't outweigh the risk.
Pam, here is one of the key questions here, though, is that when the FDA issues approval, that implies this drug is safe, this is okay to use, and this is effective. There doesn't seem to be a clear-cut case for that here. So what's the role of the FDA in all of this?
Well, I think the FDA is looking at the seriousness of this disease, the fact that millions of people have it, that there's very little on the market that actually helps for more than a few months, and they are saying that this drug seems to have a hint of benefit, and it goes after this key protein of amyloid, and that's what they're sort of banking on. Now, there isn't a lot of really strong history with drugs that have tried to attack amyloid. There's about 25 years of failed clinical trials with anti-amyloid drugs. They have succeeded in knocking down the protein and clearing it out of the brain, but they have not succeeded in producing any benefit that people would actually notice in terms of their symptoms. So that's kind of the gamble that the FDA is taking here. They're saying, we think this one is going to be the one that sort of crosses that threshold. We think that its ability to get rid of amyloid in your brain is actually going to help you see that your memory loss declines at a slower rate.
That is Pam Belloc of the New York Times joining us tonight. Thank you so much, Pam.
Thank you.
A protracted standoff between a major oil company and Northern Indigenous American tribes intensified today. Stephanie Tsai has the story.
A pipeline battle brewing in Minnesota today with the largest show of resistance yet.
We will. Stop Line 3.
We lost.
Stop
More than 1,000 protesters from across the country called for a halt to construction, rerouting part of Enbridge's Line 3 pipeline. The Canadian-based energy company transports oil produced from the tar sands in Alberta, Canada, to refineries in Superior, Wisconsin. Since 2014, it has sought to replace a section that runs through northern Minnesota. The new 340-mile replacement pipe would nearly double the amount of oil carried while crossing more than 200 bodies of water and 800 acres of wetlands. It would also run between three reservations. Resistance has only intensified since construction began in December. Dozens of protesters have been arrested.
Get out of the area immediately or you'll be placed under arrest.
Opponents say the pipeline risks spills in sensitive areas where Native Americans, the Ojibwe tribes, have treaty rights to hunt, fish, and harvest wild rice. Environmental groups also fear tar sands oil, one of the dirtiest forms of fossil fuel, will worsen climate change and threaten water resources. Those concerns are not unwarranted. In 1991, the Prairie River in Grand Rapids, Minnesota, was contaminated with nearly 1.7 million gallons of crude oil that leaked from the Line 3 pipeline, the largest inland oil spill in U.S. history. Now Line 3 is facing legal challenges at the state and federal level, but pressure is mounting for President Biden to intervene, as he did when he canceled the Keystone XL pipeline in January.
There is absolutely no question that President Biden could shut down the pipeline, Line 3.
Celebrities, including actress Jane Fonda, joined that call today.
We're going to keep coming back and making a ruckus.
Enbridge says the replacement pipeline will bring thousands of jobs to the region, meet higher demand for oil, and deliver it more safely. The project is already more than half finished.
For more on today's demonstrations and what's at stake for the Native tribes behind them, we turn to Tara Hauska, an attorney and the founder of the advocacy organization GNU Collective. She is a member of the Cochiching First Nation. Ms. Hauska, you are actually joining us, I understand, from the construction site where this pipeline is being built. Talk us through how you believe this pipeline is going to impact Native tribes.
The impacts of this project are very clear. It is a threat to our watersheds, to our wild rice tributaries, to these beautiful places we call home. It proposes to pass through over 200 water bodies, 800 wetlands, and dozens of wild rice watersheds along its path. And obviously folks are here to say that's not gonna happen, and our wild rice matters.
Tell me what happened at the protest today. I know you were expecting hundreds of people. Were there any arrests? Were there confrontations? Do you feel it was successful?
Yeah, there's actually over 2,000 folks that have shown up here in northern Minnesota doing multiple actions at different sites. There has not been any, like, really aggressive police confrontation. I think they're quite actually overwhelmed by the sheer numbers of folks that are here. And perhaps didn't realize the level of support that Native nations have and frontlines groups have across Turtle Island and the concerns that people all jointly share about our water and our future.
And what are you all calling for? Are you expecting that President Biden is going to cancel this project the way he did with the Keystone XL pipeline back in December?
If there is a want to avoid civil unrest, if there is a want to uphold tribal sovereignty and to be a climate champion, there is no way that this project should be allowed to move forward. Line 3 is the equivalent of the emissions equivalent of 50 coal-fired plants. Yeah. There are three Ojibwe nations suing against its approval. It is a violation of not only Indigenous rights, but of the rights of future generations to have a habitable planet.
So you're talking about both a climate change issue and an Indigenous rights issue, but there have been some tribes that have backed this pipeline, and there are some tribal members that are even working for the company, Enbridge, which says this is going to provide thousands of jobs. What do you have to say to them?
I'm born and raised in northern Minnesota. I am well aware of the fact that most of the good paying jobs in places like this are jobs that involve extraction. They're jobs that require us to destroy the natural world around us, whether it's cutting down the forests, extracting minerals from the earth, or building fossil fuel infrastructure projects that we are left to deal with the risks of. There needs to be investment into our economies. There needs to be respect for our economies, our existing economies, like the economy of wild rice. And it's time for something different. You know, the thousands of jobs that were promised, they were supposed to be all these local jobs. 75% is what they said. It's less than 33%. And most of those jobs are not the high-paying union jobs. They're, you know, the contracted security workers and things like that. This is not a big, huge influx of resources into our economies. It's very temporary and it's short-sighted. And we're the ones that have to deal with all the risks when these guys go home and start counting their checks. And by these guys, I mean Enbridge.
Ms. Haska, you are also a tribal attorney. Besides the protests like you're seeing today, the acts of civil disobedience, what legal recourse remains? The project is more than 60% done. It's supposed to be done by the end of the year. How do you stop it from becoming operational at this point?
Obviously, there are folks who are here that are saying that that's not going to happen. And I would say that Enbridge had promised that its pipeline project would be running years ago to its shareholders, and it's still not running. And it's because of the people coming together in the regulatory review process, in direct actions, on the ground, in courts, in litigation, that's prevented them every single step of the way. We don't want this project. And there is multiple lawsuits. There are multiple lawsuits that are proceeding, which include Minnesota's own Department of Commerce suing Minnesota's Public Utility Commission, the state actually suing itself because this pipeline was not actually justified in terms of need and oil forecast.
Tara Hauska is joining us from the construction site of the Line 3 pipeline in northern Minnesota. Ms. Hauska, thank you for your time.
Thank you so much, Miigwech.
COVID-19 has torn across India with a deadly ferocity. While infection numbers have dropped from their horrific peaks last month, more than 120,000 new cases were reported today. While Prime Minister Narendra Modi announced that all adults in India will now be eligible for vaccines, slow rates of inoculation help the disease spread. But all the while, immigrants from India here in this country and Indian Americans have raced to help friends and family back home. Here are some of their stories in their own words.
My name is Divya Balakrishnan, and I live in Sacramento, California.
I'm Vineet Singhal, and I live in Austin, Texas.
My name is Shamli Bhargayan, and I'm in Cambridge, Massachusetts.
My name is Priyank Lathwal, and I'm in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
My name is Madhushree Ghosh, and I live in San Diego, California.
Hi, I'm Sean Jayachandran. I live in Belmont, Massachusetts.
Last summer, my maternal grandfather passed away from COVID. The hardest part for us was not being able to appropriately say goodbye to him. And then just over the weekend, there was a need for an oxygen concentrator because we were seeing the O2 levels for one of my family members go down precipitously. It was an eye-opening experience to figure out a way to get an oxygen concentrator during a time when there's essentially a black market for oxygen concentrators in India. So I feel lucky that I'm, you know, my family and I are in a position to be able to do this for the folks in my family who are suffering. But at the same time, I feel extremely, I feel an extreme sense of guilt, but there's so many other folks that don't have access to the same resources and relationships that we do.
My home is Delhi, and just a few weeks ago, we began to see what was happening with the cases surge, to put it lightly. This was the same time that at my school, at the Harvard Business School, everyone was sort of celebrating graduations and vaccinations, understandably so. I began to think of raising a fundraiser for Harvard specifically. I then thought, okay, why limit to Harvard or why limit to one school? Because there's so much strength in numbers I realized that Priyank Lathwal from Carnegie Mellon was thinking of something very similar. So I reached out to him.
My mom called me last week around 2 o'clock in the night in India and saying that like a lot of her friends were getting infected and they weren't getting basic infrastructure. So I was really worried for them and, you know, I wanted to do something about it. So I put up a page together quickly, like within a couple of hours on GoFundMe. I think within 24 hours, it had gained a lot of traction. And that's when like Shambhvi reached out to me.
In just a week, we've been overwhelmed with all the support and enthusiasm from students across the country. We have about 35 student organizations, some focused on South Asia and some broader. I certainly saw a shift within myself as I moved from this state of, you know, completely being consumed in the sadness and despair to being able to make this small difference.
Since I started the fundraiser, I've lost members of the extended family. So the emotional aspect of it is something which I don't think I've had adequate time to process through. I'm just trying to keep myself busy, but I know I'll get back to it at some point and have to reconcile with that.
As a person who's Indian but living abroad, it comes with a sense of helplessness and a sense of, you know, even if I do something, it feels kind of futile. I'm just clicking a few buttons, but, you know, is it actually making a difference? Virtual yoga classes became a way for me to conduct fundraisers and raise money for very worthy causes. The fundraiser itself is sort of twofold. One is garnering the community support and really hitting home that this is an important issue that affects all of us, not only if you're Indian. And the second arm of the fundraiser work is to compassionately, as compassionately as possible, call into action influential individuals and also larger companies that have profited from Indian culture and yogic culture. It is because millions of people around the world are raising their voice that they do more than pay attention and take action.
So WhatsApp groups have been very transformational for us. So I left India in 93. This is my first school. The middle school was St. Anthony's Girls Senior Secondary School. And these are all girls. And we pretty much grew up together. If I showed up in India for a visit, you know, you ping them and the girls would come together. Sometimes they'd bring their own children along. So it's always been a fun place to share entertaining stories of each other's lives. So this WhatsApp group, as well as my middle school WhatsApp group, is now inundated with information on where you can get oxygen cylinders, where you can go for an ICU bed. Mental health and South Asia, you know, we don't talk about it as much as here, you know, in the US, but in India right now, people are just trying to survive. And there are only two ways to do this. Either we acknowledge that there will be, that the trauma that people have experienced is going to be multi-generational and do something about it, or we pretend it never happened.
I'm the founder of Crossover Basketball and Scholars Academy. The mission is to impact gender equity and education rates in marginalized communities across India by using the sport of basketball as a vehicle of change. I just got a text message today of a young girl, Ripriya, who's been in our program. She came for 3 straight years. She's waiting on medical school admission. However, her mom had her hour scaled back and now all the way cut. That's gonna put Ripriya, and it is putting her in a position of making a hard choice. Do I continue in school where I don't have necessary funding for tuition, we may not have a place to live or food, or do I put that dream aside for someone like me who had been typically traveling to India over the past decade, 1 or 2 times a year? That expectation of going is just so ingrained. So for me, it's, okay, when can we restart this program? And when can I get back to working and engaging with these kids? But for my parents, my dad was born in 1941. We're talking about a man who's older than the country itself. And the reality is, as all of our parents get older, that I'm sure none of them ever think about, this is my last time going to India, but to not be able to even think of a future moment is very, I think, disheartening for them. But I think at some point there's going to be families across the country whose parents are going to pass away here in the US, never getting to go back. And I think there's going to be a heartache that exists that's hard to understand, of like that idea of like not seeing home one last time.
The Senate has returned to work, facing a crowded agenda in what we expect could be a pivotal month on many issues. But there was news this past weekend that could throw a wrench into one piece of that agenda. It came from centrist Democratic Senator Joe Manchin of West Virginia on the issue of voting rights. Lisa Desjardins is here with me in our studio in a first in a long time. Lisa, thank you for being here. It feels strange to be in person, but it's about time.
I agree.
But here to walk us through what's going on. So let's talk about Joe Manchin. A lot of attention this weekend. He wrote an opinion piece saying he's opposed to this great big voting rights bill that Democrats have their heart set on. What's behind the opposition?
First, I want to remind folks what's in this bill. This is a critical issue to Democrats and was part of President Biden's agenda when he was running for office. This is the For the People Act, is what it's called. That's the title of the bill. Sometimes people say S1 or HR1. What's in it? Well, this contains provisions that would expand early voting and registration across the country in federal elections. It would block states from doing some of the things they're doing now, like voter purges. It would make it tougher for them to do those things. It would also end partisan gerrymandering. So this is a broad bill. And it would make that large donors would have to disclose themselves publicly, campaign finance. Now, it is a big bill. It is something that is obviously very critical right now as we see rising in this country, both sides talking about democracy and voting rights and what's happening at this moment. In comes Joe Manchin. He would be the 50th vote that Democrats would have for this in the Senate. They have 49. And here's what he said in his op-ed saying why he opposed it. He wrote, "I believe that partisan voting legislation will destroy the already weakening binds of our democracy. And for that reason, I will vote against the For the People Act." Notable, he did not have any substantive problems with the bill that he raised. Instead, he said the issue is there are no Republicans on board. Democrats, of course, have a real problem with that. They say, we think Republicans are going to play games here and block this bill. But the bottom line, Judy, at this time, this Manchin decision is a body blow to this legislation. It is not dead yet, but it is in real trouble. It's unclear if, when Chuck Schumer, the Democratic leader, will bring it back up.
And raises questions about a number of other pieces of legislation the Democrats have their heart set on. One, infrastructure, yes. This proposal by the president. The president's been having a number of conversations with Senator Shelley, the other senator from West Virginia, Shelley Moore Capito, who's a Republican. Where does all that stand?
Let's call it the political mountain state right now, right? Let me give folks a quick update on where we are in infrastructure, something that could affect almost every city in this country. The state of negotiations right now. Senate Republicans' last offer was $250 billion in new spending. This was back and forth over the weekend. President Biden has lowered sort of his, bottom line to at least $1 trillion. He has offered a compromise on how to pay for this, which is interesting, saying he would accept a lower corporate tax rate of 15%. He'd want it up to 28%. But he said corporations would have to pay that 15%. No loopholes. Now, Republicans haven't responded yet, but I think the bottom line on this one, Judy, is that this also is not going well. They are very far apart. And this is something that they don't have a lot of time to figure out. Biden wants to go big. A lot of Democrats are pushing him that way, saying end the negotiations. Republicans, they're still talking.
And you're suggesting, Lisa, and you've told us you think this month could be crucial for a number of issues before the Congress.
That's right. Senator Tim Scott of South Carolina, the Republican, told me a couple weeks ago before they left for recess that it is June or bust on racial justice legislation, police reform. So that's going to have the next 2 weeks. Infrastructure, also some spending rules. Speaker Pelosi is trying to get through her spending bills and infrastructure by the end of this month as well. All of that on top of this situation with the For the People or the Voting Rights Act. It is going to be very busy, and it's critical because the direction that Democrats choose now could lay the road for the rest of this year and maybe for the Biden administration.
Several weeks to go. It's only June
right.
7th.
It's getting
Lisa
hotter.
Desjardins, very good to have you in the studio.
Thank you. So good to be back.
And for more on some of these biggest political stories of the week, we turn to Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report and Aaron Haynes of the 19th News. Tamara Keith is away. It is so good to see both of you. And let's pick up with where we left off with Lisa on this big voting rights piece of legislation. Amy, to you first, with Joe Manchin weighing in now and saying he's not going to go for something that doesn't have Republican buy-in, where does that leave voting rights?
Well, the other thing that Senator Manchin said in that op-ed, and he has said publicly, is he supports voting rights legislation that's more narrowly tailored. And there's one of those in Congress right now that he supports, the John Lewis Voting Rights Act. Now, he says this does have some bipartisan report. It has one bipartisan co-sponsor, and that's Lisa Murkowski, senator from Alaska. But Judy, you know as well as anybody that that doesn't get you 60 votes. You need 10, not just one other Republican, to get something past the finish line. So the discussion right now is about the filibuster. Would Joe Manchin support ousting the filibuster to pass something like a more tailored voting rights bill? And the answer, which he seems to give now every 5 minutes, is no. He's not interested in getting rid of that. The one thing that I think is also important to understand is while Joe Manchin is taking the bulk of the criticism about his opposition to upending the filibuster, there are a lot of other Democrats in the Senate who quietly agree with him. He is something of a heat shield for those Democrats. He's taking all the incoming and protecting them from having to say out loud how they feel about getting rid of this filibuster, which would have really tremendous and unforeseen consequences for the future.
So, Aaron, the issues don't get much more important than voting rights this year for the Democrats. If they're not able to hold their ranks together on this, what does it say?
Well, what it says is especially to Democratic voters, is that, you know, they're questioning what it is that they voted for. Democrats asked these voters during the 2020 election to do whatever it took to get creative, to really fight for this democracy and to hand them the Democratic majority that they now have in Congress and also the presidency and the vice presidency. And so those voters are now looking to their elected officials, especially at the federal level, and expecting results. They don't care about things like the filibuster or budget reconciliation. They don't know what those things mean. They only know that they expect that their vote should be counted, and protecting or expanding voting rights is certainly a way that they would expect those, their votes to be counted. And so this is a very frustrating thing for a lot of the voters that I talk to, not to mention the organizers, the activists who galvanized so many of those voters, even in the midst of a pandemic, to turn out in the record numbers that gave Democrats a majority. But for now, a lot of those folks do not feel like Democrats are governing as if they are the ones who just won the election in 2020.
I mean, Amy, we're just, what, 6 months into the Biden administration, and to be saying, you know, throwing in the towel, although that's not obviously not what the Democrats are doing. They haven't publicly given up yet. But it doesn't bode well, does it?
It doesn't. But this is what happens in a 50-50 Senate. And it's also the reality for a Democratic Party that, look, their 50-50 Senate is only there because there are a couple of senators who represent really red states. Joe Manchin represents a state that Donald Trump won by almost 40 points. There are other members up in 2022 who represent sort of purple or swing states that also have to be aware that to win, they can't just rely on Democratic votes. And so, you know, again, this is the reality of the world in which we currently live, where just a few thousand votes separates Democrats from the majority in the House and for control of the Senate come 2022.
And while we're talking about voting and voting rights, Aaron, we did see the former president show up in North Carolina over the weekend, giving a very political speech, very critical of President Biden, former President Trump, again going after Dr. Anthony Fauci, but notably saying that he plans to get involved and campaign for congressional Senate candidates in 2022. Here's just a little bit of what former president said.
The survival of America depends upon our ability to elect Republicans at every level. Starting with the midterms next year, we have to get it done.
Aaron, what does that mean for Democrats and for Republicans? Presumably, he's firing up some Republicans, but what's the Democratic response to him?
Well, you know, I think that we have to continue to look to the states. And, you know, another GOP state convention that happened over the weekend was down in my home state of Georgia, where you definitely had some very interesting dynamics that I think could kind of portend what we can expect to see going forward for the midterms and possibly in the next 4 years. Governor Brian Kemp took the stage at the convention in Jekyll Island and was booed. This is somebody who had said publicly that Georgia's elections were fair and accurate, you know, in opposition to the former president who wanted a recount in Georgia despite those ballots being counted three times. People like Governor Kemp, people like Secretary of State Raffensperger, who, you know, talked about the integrity of the elections in Georgia, were put on, you know, put in the former president's crosshairs, folks like Marjorie Taylor Greene were hailed by Republicans in Georgia for her political, rejection of political correctness and really embrace of the former president and continued support of him. And so you had Republicans being rewarded, the Republicans who stood with former President Trump and were calling for, an investigation to look into the election results in Georgia. And so the extent to which we continue to see President Trump out on the campaign trail, which he signaled that he is willing, is something that he's going to be doing. The extent to which he continues to talk about a rigged election or the false threat to election integrity in this country, and Republicans continuing to push these laws at the state level and continuing to kind of align themselves with those ideas, I think, seeing how long the so-called big lie is going to continue to last in our election cycle. I think what we know now is, almost 6 months after the January 6th insurrection, that is still very much in our political ecosystem.
And no doubt about it. And Amy, what does the former president's involvement at this point, how is that going to change the makeup of this campaign between now and November of next year?
And potentially the makeup of Congress. Judy, the other thing he did in North Carolina, besides, as Aaron pointed out, still continuing to make the baseless claim that the election was rigged, is he endorsed a candidate for the North Carolina Senate. So why is this important? Well, when Donald Trump says we got to take back the House and the Senate for Republicans, what he is actually saying is we need to take back Congress with the kinds of candidates that are like me, or candidates that get my seal of approval. Now, some of those candidates are going to win, some of them aren't. But the fact is, if they do go on to succeed next November, it means that the Congress is going to look a lot Trumpier than it does at this moment.
And that's what we're already looking at the possibility of. Here we are, early June 2021. Amy Walter, Aaron Haynes, thank you both.
You're welcome.
And we'll be back shortly with a brief but spectacular take on the need for doctors to openly talk to patients about their loved ones. But first, take a moment to hear from your local PBS station. It's a chance to offer your support, which helps keep programs like ours on the air. We turn to civil rights activist Ruby Bridges, who writes her own story in a children's book. It's part of our Race Matters series and our art series, Canvas.
If it hadn't been for you guys, I might not be here and we wouldn't be looking at this together.
Ruby Bridges' name is synonymous with civil rights trailblazing, immortalized in this Norman Rockwell painting entitled The Problem We All Live With. Bridges' historic moment came when she became the first black child to desegregate an all-white elementary school in New Orleans at 6 years old. She had to be escorted by federal marshals as she walked past loud and unruly protesters and into the William France Elementary School. Now, 60 years later, Bridges has written 2 and 4 children, the same age of her younger self. She describes it as a call to action and contains historical photos of her pioneering time. Pioneering history is still being made and remembered, including a photo illustration that went viral after the election of Vice President-elect Kamala Harris walking alongside the shadow of Ruby Bridges.
Ruby Bridges, on behalf of my generation of civil rights pioneers, let me just say thank you for paving our way. Now, you've written other books, but this one is specifically aimed at readers who may be as young as you were when you first took those historic steps when you were 6 years old into the elementary school there. Why did you do this book, and do you see similarities between then and now in some ways?
Absolutely. You know, back in March, I was sitting in front of my television on lockdown because of the virus, like everybody else, and witnessed this young man's brutal death, Mr. Floyd, right in front of my face, like so many people did. And I was so disturbed by it and didn't know how to react or what to do. I felt like, you know, I'd been spending so many years talking to kids across the country, and I knew that they were watching this as well and probably wondering what was going on. The majority of my time, I've talk to kids and explain to them that racism has no place in the minds and hearts of our kids across the country, and yet they were witnessing this. I was very moved by what I saw after his death. I saw young people take to the street, and I felt like the torch had been passed and that now they had a cause to get behind. When Dr. King was assassinated, I felt like we should have picked that torch up and kept it moving. Even my own experience after going into the school, it was something that happened. No one talked about it in my community, in my neighborhood. It was swept under the rug and life went on. I'm happy now to see that all of a sudden activism is cool again, you know, and it should have been from 1960 until today. We didn't do a very good job of passing those lessons on to that generation.
Let's talk about teenagers and others in their 20s, the big demonstrations that are going on, multiracial, multigenerational, led by a lot of young people. But there are deep divisions from politics, even to wearing masks. There are divisions. How do you explain that?
We cannot be a hopeless people. We have to be hopeful. And we do have a lot of work to do.
One of the things that you say in the book is you believe that racism is, let me read this, a grown-up disease. You're talking to the children now, the young people. You say, we adults must stop using you, our kids, to spread it.
We all know that none of our kids are born knowing anything about disliking the child sitting next to them. Our babies don't come into the world knowing anything about racism or disliking someone because of the color of their skin. It is learned behavior. And I believe that if it can be taught, it can be taught not to be that way.
You mentioned your children. You had 4 black boys, and your eldest was involved in an unsolved murder. What is your advice to mothers like yourself and also to those protesting the murders of black men especially, but also black women?
That is a parent's worst nightmare. My son's murder was never solved. we do know that the people that actually took his life looked exactly like him. You know, there's so many parents out there, like myself, who have lost children my son's age, or, you know, even babies, by gun violence, which is very, very disheartening. That is an issue that we have to deal with as well. Whether it's the murders like the murder that happened with my son, or murders like George Floyd, if you are passionate about that, then you need to do something about it.
I'm very impressed with your passion and moved by it. And I imagine there might be a part of your book that is a favorite of yours. Is there any place that you could share with us?
Yes, I have it right here. I will definitely do that. When I think about how great this country could be, America, land of the free, home of the brave, I think about what Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said about being great. Everybody can be great because everybody can serve. You only need a heart full of grace. Really, it is that love and grace for one another that will heal this world.
Well, Ruby Bridges, it's been such a pleasure to see you once again. You are a hero for all time, in the best of times, and it will always be your time. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you. It's such a pleasure to see you again.
Carrie Kandrian is a Colorado-based social scientist. She has spent much of her career investigating how healthcare can be compromised if an open discussion with patients about what and who matters most to them is avoided. Tonight, she offers her brief but spectacular take on reimagining the language we use in healthcare, especially around elderly LGBTQ members.
Think about the script we all get in healthcare. Are you married? Do you have kids? And now think how isolating and silencing that script can be when you don't fit. I think the language we use around healthcare needs to be reimagined. Dealing with a health crisis is hard for everyone, but it's even harder for LGBT seniors. If you think of our forms, our intake questions, our admission conversations, they're all critical in medicine because they really tell us who a patient is, what they want, what they don't want, who they want in the room. And the challenge is that our questions and our forms are so scripted that they're limiting. Do you come out and risk being treated poorly, or do you stay silent and hide a fundamental part of who you are? That's a heck of a choice. So our other option is that we break these scripts. We open them up in a way that gives people space to answer in a way that fits them. I got into a major in communication pretty randomly. It was the first day of class, and it was a large lecture hall, and the professor got up the first day and said, "People are not the problem. It's the way people talk that's the problem. And if you want to change culture, you need to give people a new vocabulary." And so I really felt like I could do something about that with a degree in communication. Currently, there are 2.4 million LGBT seniors in this country, and nearly half, 48% of them, have not shared that with their doctors. People who grew up when it was basically unthinkable and dangerous to be LGBT. So to stay safe, they've spent years honing the habit of silence about a fundamental part of their identity. And research shows that the stress from hiding can take up to 12 years off their life. It's hard to break these scripts when you are fine, and even harder when you have faced this lifetime of training to be silent and knowing that you do risk being treated poorly if you do come out. Even just the not asking, "Are you married? Who's the biggest support in your life? Who do you want to have in the room?" I mean, these, just any slight change to know that it will be okay, that you can trust this person, that you can be safe with sharing this information, goes a really long way and makes a huge impact for the LGBT community. I see a lot of myself in the people that I work with, because I am one of them. And I think it does matter to a certain degree, because you do become deeply connected and wanting to do this work, and also wanting to do this work that actually leads to change. People say, you know, we are inclusive, we treat everyone the same. We should never want to treat everyone the same, because we aren't all the same. My name is Carrie Kandrian, and this is my brief but spectacular take on breaking the script in healthcare.
Something we all need to think more about. And you can find all of our brief but spectaculars at pbs.org/newshour/brief. And that's the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Judy Woodruff. Join us online and again here tomorrow evening. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you. Please stay safe, and we'll see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
Architect, Beekeeper, Mentor, a Raymond James Financial Advisor, tailors advice to help you live your life. Life well planned.
Consumer Cellular, Johnson and Johnson, BNSF Railway, the Candida Fund, committed to advancing restorative justice and meaningful work through investments in transformative leaders and ideas. More at CandidaFund.org.
The Alfred P. Sloan Foundation, driven by the promise of great ideas.
Supported by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, committed to building a more just, verdant, and peaceful world. More information at macfound.org. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is PBS News Hour West. From WETA studios in Washington and from our bureau at the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
You're watching PBS.